Well, as some of you know, we discovered that I have mice in my house. And mice has always been something, mice have always been something that I've been petrified of. In fact, last year when we discovered we had mice in the church, I was so panicked, I was afraid to go to the office. So here's a story that I love, that I found, that I thought very appropriate. A cat dies and goes to heaven. And of course, you know, we don't believe in heaven as a location, but all the stories that are so cute have heaven as a location. So bear with me on that story. So anyway, the cat dies and he goes to heaven. And of course, you know who's always at the gate? Who's always at the gate? St. Peter's always at the gate. So St. Peter meets him at the gate and says to the cat, "You have been a good cat all these years. So anything you want is yours for the asking." The cat thought for a minute and then said, "All my life I have lived on a farm and slept on a wooden floor, and I would really love a fluffy pillow to sleep on." So St. Peter says, "Say no more." Instantly the cat had a fluffy pillow. And a few days later, four mice were killed in Reverend Julie's living room in a trap. And thank goodness they all went to heaven. And so when they get to heaven, St. Peter says to them, "What would you like? I mean, you're in heaven now. So whatever you like, we'll give you." And so all the mice said, "You know what we really want? It's some little, we spent our whole lives running from people like Reverend Julie. And so what we really want are some roller skates. So we can just really get out of the way really quick." So God says, St. Peter says, "Sure, of course, you deserve it." And so they all get roller skates. And a week later, St. Peter decides to check on the cats, on the cat, on the big, wonderful, fluffy pillow, and gently awakens the cat and asks, is everything okay? You seem to be loving your pillow. And have you been happy here? Have you been comfortable here?" And the cat says, "Oh, it's wonderful, thank you. I have never been so happy in my entire life. And the pillow is fluffy, but especially, I love those meals on wheels you've been sending me every day." So, anyway, I just want the title of my lesson is Nonresistance. Can you see the connection? So, you know, when we're nonresistance, we find ourselves not paying attention to things that aren't that important anymore, and not feeling defensive and having to explain all the time. So I have to tell you, I've been working on that. And it was the floors in the fellowship hall that helped me to become non-defensive. And because I wanted those floors like yesterday, and I had to wait a whole year, but I decided that I was going to be non-resistant. I was just going to let it happen when it happens, and I've been so much happier. And so I realized that my non-resistance has been working when I was watching TV and two little mice just walked, right? They didn't even run. They felt so comfortable in my house, in that peaceful energy, that they just walked gingerly across the living room floor and into the kitchen. And it surprised me that I didn't jump on the table screaming help. I just sat there and I said, "Two little mice just walked in front of me and went into the kitchen. Why, thank you." And then I thought, I don't know how they got in here, but I'm sure that there's only two and they'll go away. And the next morning, of course, you know, you can't find them. So I moved everything. I looked everywhere. I couldn't find those two little mice. And the next evening while I was watching TV, another one. And this one was so furry. scary. Alexis tells me it's called a grasshopper mouse because they hop. But not only do they hop, but they're really cute. They look like little kittens. They're furry and they're gray and they have little pointed noses. And this was really cute. And I sat there and I said, wow, that one is really cute. It just walked gingerly just in front of me into the kitchen and into the pantry. Of course, I ran and opened the pantry and was gone. So at that point, I thought, okay, maybe I need to call the manager. So I called the manager and I said, you know what? There are mice in my house, and they're not even afraid of me. They just walk gingerly in front of me. And she says, okay, well, we'll take care of that. So she came over and she put all these traps all over my house. And the next morning I wake up, and there is that cute little gray furry one that looked like a kitten. And he's been caught by the leg, so he's not dead. But he's looking at me like, ew, I still can't get him out of my head. And that was the beginning of them calling a service to come in, and they put real traps all around the house, and the place looks like a trap everywhere you go. I said, I've got to get these traps out of here, because if I have company, it's going to be embarrassing to have them all watching where they walk. But anyway, the point is that I haven't seen another mouse, and they've been working on getting rid of the mice for me, and I realized that the immutable law of non-resistance is working in me, because I'm not crazy over it, which I would have been. I'm just like, okay, I was co-inhabiting my beautiful little house with these little mice, and they're going to leave. Because the law says that what you resist persists. So I wasn't going to get crazy resisting it. I did what I needed to do. I called them, and the pest control people came, and they took care of it, or they're taking care of it. But what you resist persists. So as soon as I stopped resisting the mice, then I found a solution. And have you ever noticed that's true for you? Like you're in a situation and somebody makes you crazy and you want to resist and you want to defend and you want to explain and you get nowhere. It seems to escalate. I remember once we had a member of the church here who was kind of sick, and she needed me to come and visit her, and I would go and visit her regularly and spend time with her and take care of her and do whatever needed to be done. And finally, the last time I went, there was someone there, and it was a person from a traditional Christian church who was waiting for me. And the minute I walked in and sat down, she started begging me about unity. And I made the mistake of not being non-resistant. I became defensive, and I started explaining, and everything I explained, she would counteract on, and then she would say this, and then I'd say that, and then she'd say this, and then I'd say that. And in the middle of all that, Jane, bless her little heart, said, can we just stop? And I realized, oh my God, I didn't get anywhere being non-resistant. All I did was escalate the situation, and it got worse and worse and worse, and there was no defending anything. Because when in our defenselessness, our safety lies. So when we try to defend, we always find all kinds of reasons to get on, and other person finds reasons, and before you know it, you haven't solved anything. All you've done is gotten yourself all upset. And so defensiveness creates stress. I was very stressed that day. I really was, because I felt that frustration of, I can't make her understand what unity really is. And I'm sure she felt frustrated too, because she was probably thinking, I can't make this unity minister understand what Christianity as I know it really is. And so both of us were very, very defensive and very, very stressed. And according to the Stanford University Medical School and research by Dr. Bruce Lipton, have any of you watched him on TV? He's a wonderful, respected cell biologist. And according to his research, stress is the cause of 95% of all illness and disease. 95%. And what creates that stress is being defensive, feeling like you have to defend what you believe, defend yourself, and not recognizing that in your defenselessness, your safety lies. Because there's no way you're going to convince anybody that you're right and they're wrong. And so defenselessness just creates that whole thing of what you resist persists, and things get worse. Most of you who watch TV have probably watched The Voice. You seen The Voice? One of my favorite shows. On Monday night, they have singers that come in and audition for that show. It's on Channel 6. And Jennifer Hudson is one of the judges, one of the voice coaches on that show. Do you remember Jennifer Hudson? Does anybody remember Jennifer Hudson, the one that singer? Well, do you remember when she was eliminated from American Idol? I was so upset. Before The Voice, American Idol was one of my favorite shows, so I never missed it. And she was one of the finalists on that show. And there's a fellow named Simon Cowell who created that show. And everybody loved Jennifer Hudson that night, but Simon Cowell, he didn't like her. He didn't think she was good enough to be the finalist on American Idol, so they eliminated her. And much to my chagrin and the boos and the thumping on the floor of the audience, she was eliminated. Now, though at the time, most of the audience thought that she was the very best singer, Simon Cowell was convinced that she wasn't, and she had to leave. And she went quietly and peacefully, and the person who won has disappeared from sight. I don't know who it was, really, not. I don't even remember who won first place, but I can tell you that that person is not in the spotlight like Jennifer Hudson is now. Because, first of all, she went on to become the popular, the leading star of Dreamgirls. Remember that movie? Which was so good, and she was so good in that movie, that she was nominated for an Oscar and got it. And then, because of her defenselessness, she never badmouthed Simon Cowell in any newspaper or any of the articles that I ever read. She never said anything bad about him, even though everybody was going like, yeah, Simon, you can see that you made a big mistake. But she ended up on Life magazine in a huge life-size picture of her with a caption under that life-size picture that said, Dream Girl Jennifer Hudson, from Idol to Oscar. And there she was. And of course, the magazine wanted to interview her and say, okay, so Jennifer, what do you think of Simon Cowell now? What would you like to say about Simon Cowell now? And this is what she said. I think that innately knowing that whatever she would resist would persist, this is what she said. She said, when I got the leading role in Dreamgirls, I never once thought about Simon Cowell. It wasn't about, Simon, I'll show you. Being eliminated from American Idol showed me that God had a different plan for my life. And of course, that different plan not only included Dreamgirls and an Oscar, but the popular show, being on the popular show every single week on Monday night, that popular show called The Voice. Non-resistance pays. It really does. It makes a difference in our lives. Even though at the time, the natural thing is to become resistant, to become defensive, to feel like you need to defend yourself. You know, in his book, The Outline of History, H.G. Wells gives the names of those he believes to be the six greatest men that ever lived. And Jesus tops the list. And do you know why Jesus tops the list? Because according to H.G. Wells, he says, the doctrine of non-resistance is the greatest truth that has ever been uttered by man. The greatest truth that has ever been uttered. And the others on the list, of course, are the Buddha, Ahsoka, Aristotle, Roger Bacon, and Abraham Lincoln. Now, Jesus' main mission on earth was to change his culture from total vengeance, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for spiritual truth to unlimited love. Talks about non-resistance in his Sermon on the Mount, which is the summary of all his teachings. So on the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, he talks about non-resistance. He says, "You have heard an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But I say unto you, resist not evil. Whoever smites you on the right cheek, turn the other cheek also. And whoever shall compel you to go a mile, go to him." Even though turning the other cheek has been grossly misunderstood over the ages, it's one of the most profound messages in the Bible. And it is because Jesus didn't mean that we should become doormats and invite further assault. Remember that he also says, pluck out your eye and cut off your hand if it offends you. These are all metaphors. He didn't mean them literally. What he really meant was that if we find ourselves upset about something, if we find ourselves really getting heated up over something and feel the need to defend ourselves, it's because we're in a strong state of consciousness. And since we know that no problem can be solved from the same consciousness that it arrived in or that it came from, then becoming defensive is a state of consciousness that only creates more problems and even compounds the problem. So becoming defensive is like being slapped on the cheek. If you don't recognize that you need to see it from the other side, the other cheek of consciousness, from the other side of your nature. We have a divine nature and we have a personality. And those are the cheeks. So if somebody hits your personality, see it from your divine nature rather than answering and from that same personality. In his book that we're teaching on Wednesday night, Discover the Power Within You, Eric Butterworth says, "You are both human and divine. There is that in you that can never be hurt, that is always poised and peaceful, and knows your spiritual unity with God, and knows that no one can take your good from you. In this divine state of consciousness, the hurt is healed. The influence of the other person on you is nullified, and you become a healing influence for him or her." Isn't that beautiful? Just think, if I had not become defensive that day, I could have been a healing influence for that woman who was waiting for me. I could have been, but I wasn't that day because I became absolutely involved in being defensive. So what I hear him saying is that if we turn the other cheek or we turn to our divine side, then our consciousness ensures that any seeming imperfection can be transformed. Anything that happens in our lives can be turned around by looking at it differently. Butterworth loves to tell a story about the famous news columnist Sidney Harris, who visited a Quaker friend for the weekend. And he noticed that when he and his Quaker friend went to get a newspaper, remember those days when you walked to the newsstand to buy a newspaper? Is anybody old enough to remember that? And so they would walk to the newsstand to buy a newspaper. And every time they went to the newsstand to buy a newspaper, Sidney and his friend were very friendly and very nice and very polite, and the guy who sold the newspaper was a grump. He would just answer in a really grunting kind of style. And so one day, Harris said to his Quaker friend, he said, "That guy is a mighty unpleasant fellow, isn't he? And why are we so nice to him?" To which the Quaker friend said, "You know what? He's always like that. He's always grumpy. But why should I let him decide how I'm going to feel?" And so that is the real truth about being non-resistance. The same truth about going the second mile, the same truth about giving the other side of your cheek. You know, going the second mile is another thing that people have really responded to negatively. What? Somebody makes me walk a mile, I should go 2 miles? Well, that came from the idea that the Roman soldiers would grab a slave, they can carry all this stuff for a mile. They just said, they couldn't say no. And so Jesus was saying to them, you know what? When that happens, you take control and say, you know what, I'm going to go another mile with you. This way, you're making the decision. You're not being forced to do it. So basically, that's what that came out of. And he's indicating that it's an uncommon way of doing something that's kind of going to throw the person who's demanding something of you off. It's going to make you look better. And he's suggesting that when we do that, when we do it defensively, that good things happen. We know that in relationships and in our workplace, that when we go the second mile, when we do a little more than is expected of us, when we're a little more pleasant than people are expecting us to be, that our life takes on new meaning. And so that's what's the meaning of going the second mile. And so the whole concept of defenselessness is where my safety lies, was the way Jesus lived his life. And everything he did, he said, we can do too. Everything he did was an example of what's possible for us. So this morning, our affirmation is, in my defenselessness, my safety lies. So you'll see that on the sheet where the daily word is, if you'll take that out now. And I want you to remember the next time that someone makes you want to be defensive, put that in your mind. You know, I always believe in having quotations in your mind. As an English teacher, once I had 300 quotations that I could call up in a second in my brain. They're not there anymore. I mean, they're there, but I don't remember them all. But I do what I do now is I try to have these little quotations in my mind so that when I need them, where was that the day I was sitting in that house being defensive? Sometimes they don't pop up, but sometimes they do. So the next time someone makes you defensive, here's what you're going to say. In my defenselessness, my safety lies. Let's say that together. In my defenselessness.